Hello, I'm Westchester County Legislator Jim Maisano. I am the county legislator for the great communities of New Rochelle and Pelham. And I'm also the vice chairman of the Westchester County Board of Legislators. And this is my cable TV show, The Good Government Forum. On this show, we interview movers and shakers in the Westchester County community and learn about the issues we face as a county. And today I have a great guest, as usual, my friend John Ravitz from the Business Council of Westchester. Welcome, John.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you for coming. So to start, I'm going to tell you that I know you before you know me.
It's a scary thought.
It's a scary thought, yeah. Right? Well, the way I know you is that when I was a young Republican, I was asked to go in to do a campaign in Manhattan for some young guy named John Ravitz, who was a state assemblyman who was running for the state Senate, and it was you.
Yes, it was, and that was a campaign I wish I didn't have to do, but I did it, and I'm glad. Thank you for volunteering. I'm sorry we didn't win it, but I served in the state assembly for 12 years,
right.
Representing a part of the east side of Manhattan. I had the distinction of being the only Republican assembly member in Manhattan, and it was the first Republican to hold that seat in 28 years. And so it was a great 12-year run. I learned a lot, and I now watch you guys from the sidelines and marvel that you do what you do.
It's kind of cool to watch from the sidelines.
Oh, it's
right?
Great watching from the sidelines. It really is.
It's great. All right, so you were assemblyman for 12 years on the Upper East Side of Manhattan. But let's take a step back. Where'd you grow up?
Grew up in Brooklyn.
Okay, grew up in Brooklyn.
Went to college out in the Midwest, where I lost my Brooklyn accent, they
Where'd
tell
you go?
Me. Earlham College in Richmond, Indiana.
Okay.
Came back and went to NYU School of Social Work, got my social work degree, was doing child welfare for a city agency, had always liked politics in terms of working on campaigns for candidates I liked. I didn't care about the party, I just wanted to, somebody who had issues that I liked, I would work on their campaigns. And there was an opening for a staff position for a congressman on the east side of Manhattan, Bill Green. And I went in and we talked and I said, well, I'm a social worker. And he said, that's exactly what I'd love to have for my district office, to be able to go into the community, work on programs, help the constituents on a one-on-one basis. And he was a great teacher. And I worked with him for 6 years. And in that 6 year, there was a dispute that was happening in the community. The incumbent assemblyman had really botched what I thought had been years of work, and he had blown it all up because he made some stupid comments. And I was in the office and I was screaming and yelling and ranting about this assemblyman. And the congressman turned to me and says, well, then you run.
Right.
And I ran. I didn't win that election. I got 42% of the vote, and I made a commitment if I got over 40% of the vote, I would run again. Probably shouldn't have gotten that 40% the first time, because then I would have done something else. I ran again 2 years later and won that seat. And as I said, I held it for 12 years. So it was a good learning experience working on the district side of the, and then moving into Albany.
Well, funny, I remember Bill Green, the congressman, for a couple of years while I was in after law school. When I was a young lawyer, I had an apartment in Manhattan, and I met him outside one of the subway stations campaigning one time.
Yep. He taught me one invaluable lesson, Jim. He always said, look, you know, when we campaign in Manhattan, unlike what you guys have to do in Westchester, you can go door to door. We could say we could go doorman to doorman, but
right.
We really couldn't get into people's homes. So you would have to do what we called retail campaigning. You'd campaign at the subway stops, you'd campaign at the supermarkets. And Bill taught me very early on, he would do a subway stop once a week, whether it was a campaign season or not. And so I adopted that, and quite frankly, as soon as I got something in my first few weeks in office, I was back out at the subway stop. One guy came up to me and goes, look, I voted for you so you could get the heck out of my subway stop. but it was a good lesson because, look, and that was, God knows, 28 years ago, there's still a lot of cynicism about politicians.
Sure.
And what you do every day tries to break that cynicism by really being out there and talking to your constituents, working with your constituents. And people, I think, respond to that when they see somebody who really has that commitment to their community.
I always believed, my little saying is, politics is in the streets.
Yep.
You know, it's not in some fancy office building. You have to go out, you have to go into the community, walk the streets of the community, go to the groups, neighborhood groups, go to the events and have a conversation with people. And you learn a lot. You know, people don't realize, I think sometimes people think elected officials either know it all, think they know it all. But the truth is, a lot of the best issues we ever come up with come from talking to people at a Chamber of Commerce dinner, mm-hmm. or going to a feast in a, yep. at a church. Sometimes you learn the best issues just by chatting with your constituents.
And listening. And listening. And what I always tell the story that when my first year in the assembly, I was asked to debate a bill on behalf of some of the grocery store and bigger store owners who had it was a bill that really would hurt dairy farmers. And I'm debating the bill, and one of my colleagues, Dave Townsend, who represented the Utica-Rome area, came up to me after the debate, and he goes, "Have you ever been to a dairy farm?" And I said, "No, I know milk by taking it out of the freezer, and that's it." And so a few weeks later, I spent 2 days with him, traveling around Oneida County and Chemung County, visiting dairy farmers, and I learned what they go through every day.
Sure.
And that made me, I think, a better legislator, because you're in this bubble, and the more you can expand what you know about not only your constituents, but the rest of the state is very important.
Especially when you're the Upper East Side of Manhattan State Assembly.
Yes, exactly. Exactly.
All right. So now everybody knows who John Ravitz is. Now let's go to today. Mm-hmm. You are, give us your title at the Business Council of
Westchester. I'm the Executive Vice President and Chief Operating Officer for the Business Council of Westchester. I work with Marcia Gordon, who is our President and CEO of the Business Council of Westchester. And we're the county's largest business membership organization.
Give us a summary. Who is the Business Council of Westchester?
Sure. We have about 1,000 members, and they range from the big multi-international companies that we're so grateful are here in Westchester, like IBM and MasterCard and Pepsi and Heineken USA, to all of the hospitals and universities, to the biotech firms, to the professional service firms. We have 100 non-for-profits, and we actually have 120 non-for-profits. And what's so important about non-for-profits, and what we have to remind stakeholders, non-for-profits create jobs, and they bring in revenue to their municipalities. Sure. So it's very important to always think of them not just as doing the great work that they do, but also they're a business. And we have small businesses.
Let me give you another piece, if I can, about not-for-profits, I find as a legislator, just kind of dovetails with what you just said, and that is for some services that previously governments have provided, we have not-for-profits that can provide the same service without utilizing county employees with the big pension, yep, and the big benefits, and they can provide the same service at a lower cost. So not-for-profits have been a tremendous help for us to control spending at the county government.
And you and your colleagues at the Board of Legislatures, I think, have tapped into so many of the key not-for-profits that they have people who are trained, they have people who are dedicated and committed to providing those services, and so it's a natural fit. So we want to advocate for them. And then we have the small, mid-sized businesses, and even the what we call our solo entrepreneurs, people who have a passion and a vision, and they're a one-person shop. And so our goal is to help our members grow by giving them the opportunity to build relationships with each other or with other stakeholders in the region. We help market their businesses by promoting what they do, by really being the cheerleader for them. And then we advocate for them on all levels of government. And that's what I also head up, which is really making sure that, again, our legislators on all levels of government, the county, state, and the federal level, understand that there are some things that are really important that they need to pass in terms of legislation that are going to help businesses. And there are sometimes legislation that can really cause major problems, sure, for industries. And again, I use my experience as a legislator, and I always tell the story that, you know, a legislator can write a one-page bill and have all the best intentions in the world, think they're doing it for the right reasons, and not think about, because they really don't know, about what the ramifications could be to either that industry or even related industries in terms of the negative effects. So when I go back up to Albany now and lobby my former colleagues, I remind them of that, because I say, you know what, you just need to listen. And again, it goes back to listening about, again, what could happen if a bill passes or a bill sometimes doesn't pass that could be harmful. So we create each year our legislative agenda. Your office got one right hot off the presses in February.
I saved it.
So this goes out to every elected official on all levels of government, the county, state, and federal level, and it's our playbook. But it's a fluid playbook because, again, there's so many issues that you're facing every day, that our members are facing every day. We're in the last 10 days of the session in Albany, and there's some bills out there that we want, and there's some bills out there that we hope just goes away very quietly and don't get brought to the floor for debate. So, you know, our goal is to really, again, be that voice and be that advocate for our members.
So let's say you're the voice of the business community in Westchester County, mm-hmm, and I imagine many counties have similar voices. Do you kind of all lobby together up in the state capitol?
There are some issues where and it's important to build coalitions. And I think, again, one of the things as a former legislator I always appreciate is when you could have groups from all over the state who are all together on one issue, either on supporting it or even opposing it, because then you're realizing that this legislation has major effects for the entire state. So one example is the scaffold law. We have been a leader in Westchester, but we're one of the leaders in a statewide coalition to try to remove that absolute liability that every other state in the country has taken out of their laws except New York.
I can't believe that law never goes away in New York State. Well, it's a really horrible law. You can't possibly look at it objectively and not realize that it's a negative law for business that's unneeded.
Well, it's a negative law, and it really is hurting Westchester businesses. I mean, it's hurting taxpayers in New York State to the tune of about $85 million.
Maybe you can explain the scaffolding law.
Scaffolding law was created, again, for all the right reasons, for anyone who had any injuries that occurred on any type of job site where there was vertical, somebody was on a scaffold. What was put into the law was something called absolute liability. So. And there were no provisions to caveat what that absolute liability meant. So that would mean that even if a worker is trained in all the safety precautions by their employee, they have a bad day, they come to work drunk, or they're upset about something, and they don't use all the safety precautions that they've been trained to do, and they get injured on the job, they can sue everybody. They can sue, obviously, their boss, they can sue the building, they can sue all the tenants in that building, and there's no way to stop that from going to trial. So 49 states in the country had absolute liability. 49 states have taken that absolute liability out. Because why? They've already seen that it really doesn't do anything to help worker safety. And we never want to do anything to prevent doing all we can to protect our workers. And more importantly, go after the bad actors who don't do the proper training for their workers, especially in those workers who are in scaffolds or in construction jobs that are high risk. But this has nothing to do with that. This simply has something to do with a very powerful group in Albany, the trial lawyers, who really continue to want to see this as their bread and butter.
And you have most trouble in the state assembly passing this, right?
We have a bill in the assembly now that's it's a better bill than we've had before. Assemblyman McDonald from the Albany area has it, which just deals with the absolute liability. And we're hoping to get a Senate sponsor for next year. I think what we've tried to do as part of this statewide coalition is we've brought in groups like from minority and women-owned businesses who are certainly affected by this because they can't get insurance policies written. So they can't bid on construction jobs if they don't have any insurance holders who are going to write policies because of the absolute liability law. We've brought in last year groups from Habitat of America who want to be able to build and do their mission, but they can't because they can't get the contractors on board because of the absolute liability and the scaffold law. So we're continuing to, again, educate our members. We're meeting them in their district offices. We're going up to Albany. I'm hoping next year we can get it in the budget because I think that's probably the cleanest way to do it. But that's just one issue of a mandate that really hurts New York and hurts creating an environment where we want to not only retain businesses and hope they grow, but also recruit businesses from all over the country.
All right, so the month of June is normally the end of the annual legislative session.
Mm-hmm.
Is there one hot item that you're working the hardest on?
There are a few. And again, some of them are ones that we hope don't get passed. Some of them are bills that we have worked on with our members. We have one bill, a preceptor bill, which again is it's a little insider baseball, but for all of the students who are going to be health practitioners, they have in the past had a great opportunity to go on rotations with doctors, nurses, physical therapists, and it's no charge to them, but they use those rotations for improving their education and getting ready for medical school. And it's been a free process. Because we have such an increase of medical schools from outside of the country now coming in with students, they're actually now paying these doctors and nurses to be able to do these rotations for our students. The problem is that's going to hurt Westchester colleges that are involved in this program and New York State colleges who are involved in this program because they're now going to have to compete with this type of program. So we've drafted a bill. Senator Murphy has it in the Senate. Assemblywoman Gunther has it in the Assembly, which gives what we think is a very strong and solid tax credit for any health practitioner that would continue to do these preceptor rotations. And what's important about these rotations, Jim, is that the students who do that hopefully go to medical school in New York and stay in New York.
Right, absolutely.
Because what we've seen time and time again is we're giving students the best medical education they can get, and then they're leaving New York. So we're hoping that this bill passes. We'd still have some mandate relief bills that are out there that we hope pass. You know, the danger and the flip side of the last few weeks of session, as you know, is you can have bills passed in the last hours that should never pass.
Trust me, I know.
And last year we had a what I thought was a really devastating blow when 11 hotel occupancy bills passed, all affecting New York, Westchester municipalities, literally the last hour of session.
Right.
And what was ironic is
which means you didn't have really a chance to get in there at the last moment and lobby the legislators.
Well, what was so frustrating was last year, at the end of the 2016 session, those bills passed. The governor waited until December and vetoed them.
Right,
and he vetoed them because he said, look, I'm not going to do this piecemeal. If we're going to do something like this, I want a statewide program in place. Well, there was no statewide program. Again, comes the end of the session of last year, they passed it, and the governor signed the bills. So really, what does that mean to our hotel industry? It means that, you know, our hotel industry in Westchester County is so important. Again, it's creating jobs. It's creating venues that are bringing businesses from all over the country and to use as for conferences, as well as we have companies like IBM and MasterCard and Pepsi that bring in teams of folks from all over the country, and they stay in Westchester for weeks at a time working on a project.
Sure.
And they use the hotels as their homes. Well, that's where this occupancy tax is going to hit them. So one of the things, again, I had to get educated on by Dan Conte, who is on our board of directors, who's also the general manager of the Westchester Marriott, and he's the chair of the Westchester Hotel Association, is this 3% occupancy tax isn't really going to hit Mr. and Mrs. Maisano or Mr. and Mrs. Ravitz if we stay at the Rytown Hilton for a night.
Right.
But it is going to hit those businesses that use suites of rooms for months at a time.
Sure.
Those businesses or organizations that want to have trade shows or conferences, they're going to look at this and say, you know what, I could go to Rockland County and not have to worry about this 3% occupancy tax. So those bills sunset next year, and we're going to have to fight to get them repealed.
All right, so let's look at the overarching issue, right? So you're an advocate, Business Council of Westchester are advocates for the business community in Westchester. And what I've said since the day I got elected 20 years ago is that the great piece of economic development in a county like Westchester is they can drive revenues to government so we don't have to raise taxes.
Mm-hmm.
And here we are in this climate right now where pretty much across the board, local governments don't want to raise taxes, nor can they even with the tax cap.
Right.
So to some degree, the only hope for Westchester to provide the services we need without raising property taxes is to increase economic development. So
mm-hmm.
your work and your organization's work is so critically important to every person that lives in Westchester County, because if we don't have a thriving business community and we don't have economic development, we're not going to have the revenues to run the governments of Westchester, whether it's a village, a town, a city, or a county, or a school district. So these are such critically important issues. And unfortunately, what I've seen as a legislator for two decades is some legislators are so anxious to pass a law, they don't look at the full effect of the law and how it's a drag on the economy and drag on businesses.
Yeah. Now,
this is probably like your whole mantra for your whole career, but I get it. And I've kind of lived it as a legislator. I'm sometimes blown away, but I see friends who are elected officials pushing legislation that I know is harmful to the business community.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's so I just described to you why I think it's so important for economic growth to fund government. But the other piece is that we need jobs.
Mm-hmm.
We need jobs that the kids of Westchester, whether it's after high school or after college, we want them to stay here. If they go to college, come home to Westchester and to work here. So I'm sure everything I just said are huge pieces of your meetings of the Business Council of Westchester. And I know some legislators are with you on this. We realize how critically important economic development is and why it has to drive the decision-making process at government.
Right. Well, I'll just touch on two things you said. One, on our future workforce, and obviously creating jobs for our kids are going to, in the future, employees of the state are so important. We work with Westchester County, and we oversee their summer jobs program at the Business Council of Westchester. We create over 250 summer jobs for what we call the at-risk youth between 16 and 24. And we work with the youth bureaus of Yonkers and White Plains and Mount Vernon to try to really get those kids into a position. Under the federal legislation called WIOA, don't ask me to spell that all out for you, but that actually expanded the workforce development program for municipalities, because now we're creating mentorships, we're creating some apprenticeships, we're creating job shadowing, all to give kids the exposure to industries that they might not even know exist, or that they could actually see themselves being involved in. But you need those jobs.
Sure.
And Westchester County, I think, has done a great job in creating clusters of industries that now have really put Westchester on the map. Our biotech cluster for the Westchester and Hudson Valley.
Yep. Okay, so we're gonna do a segue, if you don't mind. So, because I wanted to talk to you about the biotech economic development project that was recently passed by the Board of Legislators to much fanfare. We were very proud, the Board of Legislators working in a bipartisan way on North 60, which is going to be a $1.2 billion economic development project that's going to bring biotech center up onto the campus on the grasslands up by the medical center, Westchester Medical Center in Valhalla. And we all think that this has tremendous potential to kind of really stimulate job creation and economic development for the county. I know you were involved for years in this North 60 project, as we call it. Tell me what you think about North 60.
Well, first of all, again, congratulations, because it really did take a lot of hard work by the legislature to go through the weeds of this plan and really get the community understanding what we're trying to do. You know what I would love? I would love, and I don't think we'll be doing this, but in 20 years, you and I sit down and talk about the North 60 project now and what it's created for Westchester County and the state. Think about the jobs that are going to come.
Think of the
jobs that are going to come and the people who are going to live in communities throughout Westchester County, who are going to go to our schools, who are going to shop in our stores, who are hopefully going to also have spouses and who are entrepreneurs and starting their own businesses in Westchester County. I mean, it really is an open invitation for creating economic growth for Westchester County. And it's going to be staffed by biotech leaders of the world, who are going to come here and make Westchester County their home and hopefully invent and find cures for diseases that are ones now that we think never can be solved.
So for listeners at home, it's a biotech development. It's going to cost $1.2 billion. It's going to take us maybe 10 to 15 years to get the entire development built. It's going to be biotech offices, medical offices, retails, hotel. It's just bringing this incredible development to vacant county land.
Yep.
So we have vacant county land that we're going to build this on, and we really believe it's going to be a hugely important part of the future of Westchester County.
And you couple that with what we're already seeing in Westchester County with the great work that Regeneron has done and Accorda and Contrafect. I mean, these are all leaders in the biotech field. And when you think about a Regeneron, they have made such an investment in Westchester County. They continue to expand their footprint. Len Schleifer, who is their president and CEO, who's a visionary in the biotech world, has really, I think, hopefully made the idea of biotech companies from all over the world coming to Westchester County a viable option.
So they, so the biotech companies that are existing now that are probably members of the Business Council of Westchester, have you talked to them about the North 60? Is that something?
Sure. I mean, we're not trying, you know, they're going to keep working and they're going to keep growing, and now they're going to have partners that they can work with, and they're not going to have to travel to other parts of the country to work with them, because hopefully they'll be here in Westchester County. And so it will be a collaborative, as we said, a cluster of these biotech leaders who are going to hopefully do some amazing things, but again, create real jobs and real long-term existing
and
jobs.
Terrific jobs.
Yep.
Jobs that pay well and you have a real career.
Yep.
And we're going to work with the colleges.
Yep.
Part of the development was that this biotech center will work with the colleges and the we also have a medical school here in Westchester County. They're going to work as well. So there's so many opportunities for better things to happen for the county. I love the North 60 project. I have to tell you, from the first minute they came in to explain to me, I was ready to vote for it. While I understood the legislators had to go through the process, the due diligence, ask a lot of questions, and make changes, which I was cool with, and I was involved in the process to make the law better and the lease better. It's a 99-year lease that the county is going to give to this developer. But I was ready to vote yes on day one, just because it's such an exciting development for the future of the county.
Yeah, and again, it really is an opportunity, again, to continue to show businesses outside of the biotech industry that Westchester is a good place to come and grow and build their businesses. And that's what we want to do. Hospitality, we talked about the hotels. Again, there's so many different areas for young people to get jobs in hospitality, in terms of communications, in terms of security, in terms of facilities. There's so many pieces of a hospitality industry that need to be filled with jobs that hopefully we can have our young people move into in the years to come.
All right, well, I'm glad you're here today, because it's so important, I think, for people. Sometimes people get so caught up kind of watching politics happen, particularly in D.C., where everybody's so turned off by it. They forget about the work that's happening in their own county that's so critically important to the place they live. You know, I tell some of my constituents that Everybody's focusing on what happens on Washington, D.C.
Mm-hmm.
Focus on Albany.
Yep.
Focus on Washington. Focus on the Pelham Town Board or the New Rochelle City Council. There's so many important issues being debated about the future of this county right here where you live. You know, if you only follow what's going on in Congress, you're missing a lot of really important issues.
Well, and what was Tip O'Neill's favorite saying? All politics is local.
Absolutely.
And that's really what it comes down to. And again, I think what you and Mike Kapowitz and your fellow board members have done at the Board of Legislatures is so important over these last few years, because you can disagree on an issue, you can debate an issue on the floor of the eighth floor of the County Board of Legislatures during a hearing, but at the end of the day, you have to get something done.
Right. So the listeners know John is referring to, we have a bipartisan leadership coalition at the Board of Legislators. The chair is Mike Kapowitz, a Democrat. I'm the vice chair as a Republican. We put together a solid group of legislators, both Democrat and Republican, to be in the leadership so that we're focusing on professionalism, collegiality, a serious review of issues, and trying to push as much as we can partisan politics on the side to do our jobs properly. And it has worked great. And thank you for saying that.
Well, it has. And what have you done? You've passed budgets that are on time, which in my 12 years in Albany, we never passed a budget
right on
time. They're balanced. They're protecting the bond rating, which is important. And those are all things that the business world looks at. If I'm going to come to Westchester County, well, I'm going to look to see if that their fiscal house is in order. I'm going to look to see that I'm not going to all of a sudden get stuck because the County Board of Legislatures and the County Executive are always at war with each other.
Absolutely.
And so I think that has been a huge, huge important step. And you're one of the architects for that. So I congratulate you on
that. Thank you, John. And I agree. You know, for the business community, they're about to invest a lot of money in the county. That's going to bring revenues and jobs to the county. The last thing we want them to be sitting here watching chaos.
Yep.
They need a process, a decision-making process that's fair and thoughtful,
mm-hmm.
And the due diligence is done in a time frame that makes a business sense. So we've really done that with the Board of Legislators, whether it was Playland or North 60, and we're going to keep doing that for the years to come. So I see that we're winding down on the show, so I want to thank you for coming.
Well, thanks for having me.
My pleasure. It's important for people to know that there are voices for the business community out there in Westchester, and the Business Council of Westchester does a great job. I've really enjoyed working with you. I went to your expo recently,
mm-hmm.
which was fabulous. So many tables of all different businesses.
Yep. It's the largest business tabletop trade show in the Hudson Valley.
It was
and
terrific.
It continues
so
to grow.
If you're watching at home, keep an eye next year for the Westchester Business Council's Business Expo. It's a great event to learn more about the businesses
mm-hmm.
Of Westchester County. So please keep up the good work. We need you. Trust me. The business community, without a voice, sometimes I don't think people understand how critically important it is to have thriving businesses in Westchester. I feel like I do, but I want everyone to know this. And I want you to keep advocating, keep doing what you're doing, because it really matters to the future of this county.
Well, and we appreciate that, and we appreciate your leadership, and we look forward to continue working with you as well.
Thank you. All right, so thank you, John Ravitz. Thank you for those who tuned into the show. I greatly appreciate it. I'm County Legislator Jim Maisano. We'll see you on the next show.